Hello, everyone. Welcome to this webinar. My name is Deb Russell, and it's my pleasure to host tonight's event. I want to begin by thanking the Marie Center for inviting our center, the Western Canadian Center for Deaf Studies at the University of Alberta, to collaborate on this adventure. So thank you for providing this wonderful PD opportunity for both of our countries. Specifically, I'd like to acknowledge the hard work of Amy Kroll, Marie Center, and Robin Demko, my assistant at WCCDS, for their management of this particular event. Thanks are also due to the National Clearinghouse, obviously, for supporting us with the technology, and to Jesse and Mike, thank you for keeping all of us connected for the next hour and 30 minutes. I know that my notes say that I should thank the interpreters and the captionist at the end, but I'd like to do that right now. I'd like to thank our interpreting team. We'll be joined this evening by Kirk Newroff and Darlene Ensenet, our interpreters, and our captionist tonight is Sharon James. So thank you to all three of you for your contribution in making sure that we are accessible to all of our viewers. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker, and to know that for all of you as participants, you may have questions during the presentation. Feel free to send those in the chat box, the text box, and we'll keep a track of those questions, and then after Jemina's done speaking, we'll address all of those questions, and there'll be plenty of time for that. So let me begin by introducing Dr. Jemina Napier, who really needs no introduction if you've been in the field for very long. There are so many things that we could say about Dr. Napier. First of all, she's the director of the Center for Translation and Interpreting Research at Macquarie University in Australia. She is an interpreter extraordinaire. She's an educator extraordinaire and an interpreter researcher extraordinaire. Her sign languages, British Sign Language, what we saw today. She can also use American Sign Language. She's known to be an international sign interpreter as well. She possesses a PhD in linguistics. We first met some 12 years ago when we were both just done our PhDs at the first DIT conference in Portland that I had attended. Jemina is a woman of action, so something that I value very much. She established the AUSLAN, an English interpreting program, in 2002. She became the head of translation and interpreting programs at Macquarie in 2007. She is extensively published. As well, she contributes as the editor to the International Journal Interpreter Education, published through CIT. She also serves on the inaugural board of the World Association of Sign Language Interpreters. It's been my pleasure to know her as a colleague and as a friend. And please welcome this warm and richly talented woman to our webinar this evening. And thank you, Jemina, for sharing your time and your talent on this busy trip with us this evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dev, for that very kind introduction. I wish I could say it's lovely to see you all this evening. I can't see you, but you can see me. And I believe that some webinar presenters don't have the visual sometimes, that you can only hear them and not see them. And if that was the case here, then you wouldn't be able to see me blushing after that introduction from Deb, which was very generous. So thank you very much for that introduction. As Deb said, we are very happy to take questions throughout the webinar. I have planned to present for approximately 45 minutes or so. And you'll see that I'll be moving through my PowerPoint presentation throughout the webinar. And then towards the end, we'll have some time. I've made sure we've got plenty of time to take your questions and to make sure that we can have some discussions, hopefully, to engage with this topic around research and best practices in community interpreting and to mediate or not to mediate. That is the question. It's a topic that I've started to think about a lot lately. Let's move on to the next. Oops. Sorry, I think I just jumped to the end one. So try that again. Oh, there we go. I've now mastered the technology. hello to some familiar names I can see in the participant list. I believe we have 43 participants, and it's nice to meet those of you who are new. You'll have seen from the description of the webinar that the purpose of this webinar is to give an overview of how interpreting research in spoken and sign languages and sign language interpreting has really influenced our thinking around best practice and community interpreting practice, what we mean by that. So what I'm doing is really drawing on quite a lot of spoken language interpreting research to get us thinking about the way that the paradigm, if you like, around community interpreting has shifted, has changed, and has influenced our thinking as sign language interpreters as well. But that there are still more questions, I think, that we need to be asking, and I think that this is an ongoing conversation that we can have. So hopefully this is just the beginning. All of you should have received information about the reading, which I recommend, and I apologise that initially there was only every other page in those readings, and it was brought to my attention when I did send an updated copy. So if for any reason you didn't get the updated copy before the webinar today, then I believe you could contact Amy and that can be passed on to you. So there is an updated copy of both of those chapters where you can actually read the whole thing properly. So I apologise for that. The reason I selected these two papers is that Franz Pochacker is someone who is really a leading scholar in talking about community interpreting in spoken languages. He has come from a conference interpreting background, but over the last 10, 15 years, he has been really instrumental in pushing the boundaries in our thinking around community interpreting. He questions, he provokes, and he's done a lot of research, so he's provided evidence to really challenge our thinking around our role as interpreters, but what we do linguistically as well. So I've always really admired his work and would like to think that I've learned a lot from him, and he has contributed, I think, to me being a very critical researcher, reflective researcher in asking questions and trying to be maybe not too provoking, but slightly. I also chose a chapter by Lorraine Leeson and her colleague, which is actually the introductory foreword for a new book that just very recently was published, which is an edited volume which features sign language interpreting research, the most up-to-date, cutting-edge sign language interpreting research from various authors from all over the world. And it's a great volume. You've got the full reference. Their introduction really serves to introduce that book, and I thought it was a really nice way to touch on some of the key issues that I want to touch on in relation to research in our field, but also to give you a little bit of a taster of the things that are in that book. So if you're interested, you might want to follow up. So you could see the kinds of research that is being done right now by people in our field. And that research is being done not by academics in their ivory tower. This has been done by practitioners, by interpreters who are out there, they're in the field every day at the coalface, and they're identifying these key issues, these concerns, these questions, and they're either going ahead and doing the research or they're collaborating with other interpreters, other academics to really test our understanding of what it is that we do. So I hope you enjoyed those readings. So what are we talking about when we say community interpreting? What do we mean? And I thought it was worth highlighting that because there are various terms that are used in different countries. In Australia, where I am based, we use the term community interpreting to represent all languages. And I'll talk a bit more about what we mean by community interpreting, what the definition is. We'll talk more about that in a moment. But in the UK, they talk about public service interpreting. In various other places, they've talked about cultural interpreting, dialogue interpreting, ad hoc interpreting, liaison interpreting, export interpreting, and some are even specific to talk about medical or legal interpreting. So we can see that there are a wide variety of definitions, different terms that are used basically to mean the same thing. Some people would question whether community interpreting is a distinct form of interpreting. So it's worth us revisiting what we mean by community interpreting or public service interpreting or whatever you want to call it. What do we mean by community interpreting? What does that mean to us? Jean Tillet actually questions whether we need to distinguish between community and conference interpreting, and has actually asked this question back in 1997, and I think it's a question we still need to ask, something we need to keep revisiting, because things move and change. At the conference that we're at here at the moment in Denver, we've been talking a lot today about technology and the impact of technology on our practice as sign language interpreters and specific to legal context. But I think that we could all acknowledge that the advent of technology is impacting on our work in the community more broadly, wherever we work. And it's also impacting on our work in conferences as well. So over time, we might need to then redefine what we mean by community interpreting again when we think about, well, where does the technological aspect fit and does that change things? Another question. But essentially, what are the characteristics of this type of interpreting? So when we look at community interpreting, when we think about community interpreting, what do we expect to see? This is one definition written by some colleagues of mine in Australia. They call it community-based interpreting, so interpreting that's based in the community. And they say that this encompasses interpreting which takes place in everyday or emergency situations in the community. Possible settings include health, education, social services, legal and business. So Cheshire now have tried to embrace the range of different settings where essentially what's happening is that people are face-to-face. They're having some kind of interaction, not necessarily across the table, but they're meeting together face-to-face, and there's certain requirements, certain parameters that we can expect to see in those contexts. So community interpreting tends to be the kind of everyday stuff, what people do on a day-to-day basis, that whether it's accessing institutional services or support or various other things that need to happen on a daily basis. That's really what we can think of as community interpreting. So when we consider the parameters, various people have proposed different parameters that define interpreting and community interpreting in particular. So we can look at the setting, so where is it happening? We can look at the technique, so are people using simultaneous or consecutive interpreting? And these are the spoken languages initially, and I'll talk a bit more in a minute about how that applies to sign language. You can talk about language direction. You can talk about the interpersonal aspects, the social dynamics, and the participant goals. So why are people there in the first place? So when we look at these parameters, the spoken languages, you can see how community interpreting can be distinct, very distinct from conference interpreting. Because depending on the setting, spoken language interpreters will be working simultaneously, usually only in conference settings, and they'll be very removed from their clients. They're often in the simultaneous interpreting booths at the back of the room, and the clients, the conference participants will hear a disembodied voice, you know, over a set of headphones, but they might never actually physically see their interpreter. Sometimes vocal language interpreters will work simultaneously and do whispered interpreting, for example, in court. But generally, outside of conference settings, anywhere in the community, spoken language interpreters will work consecutively because they have to, because of the overlap between the two spoken languages, the interference, so it necessitates them working consecutively. Language direction is another key thing. In conference interpreting practice, there tends to be the recommendation that conference interpreters work into their A language. So your first language tends to be your dominant, your stronger language. So interpreters will work into their first language, into their A language. And in the community setting, in a face-to-face setting, the interpreter will have to work in both language directions, because that's the whole point of the dialogue. So there's two people talking and an interpreter there, there are inevitably two languages being used. And the goals of the interaction. So often in a conference setting, delegates are seeking information, but they're there as experts already in their field, and they're seeking new information. What can they learn? What can they take away from that conference? Whereas participants in a community setting will have very different goals. If it's in an educational setting, they'll be looking to learn, and there'll be certain requirements around what they have to take away from that context. If it's a social services or welfare setting, then they might be looking for support services, financial support, or other forms of support. In a courtroom, again, participant goals will be very different. So these are the sort of parameters that have been set out for spoken language interpreters. So let's consider then how they apply to us as sign language interpreters. The setting, yes, that's relevant. That does influence the way that we work, the way that we engage with our clients. It influences choices that we make around what we're doing. Technique. Now, this is an interesting one, isn't it, I think, for us as sign language interpreters, because we tend to work simultaneously because we can. One of our languages is silent. But more recently, over the last decade or so, especially since Deb Russell completed her PhD, we've started to recognise that consecutive interpreting is valid and valuable for us to consider as a technique, depending on the context. And so more and more now we're seeing that sign language interpreters will use consecutive interpreting in medical and legal contexts. But it's still not the norm, at least not in Australia. And I believe from some of my conversations with people here in the US and perhaps in Canada too, that it's probably still not the norm for most practitioners, because our default is simultaneous. With the spoken language interpreters, their default tends to be consecutive when they're in the community setting. The other parameter is in relation to language direction and the fact that for the majority of sign language interpreters, we work into our second language. Sign language is often the second language that we have learned, but most of our work is in that direction, from English into American Sign Language, or in my case, Australian Sign Language. So the social dynamics and participant goals would be the same as they would be for spoken language interpreters working in community settings. I don't see that there would be any major differences there in those parameters. So let's consider some of these parameters in a little bit more depth, and we can look at a particular typology that has been suggested. Again, this dates back to 1997. So this is towards the end of the 1990s, there was a lot of seminal work that was happening around spoken language interpreting and community interpreting in particular, which has really changed our thinking. People have started to acknowledge that proximity is crucial. And the fact that conference interpreters have distance from their clients means that they can adopt a particular role. The way they perform their function as an interpreter is very different from a community interpreter because they don't have to sit and make direct eye contact with their clients. But for us, the sign language interpreters, even when we're working in a conference setting, we still have to make eye contact with our clients. Otherwise, we can't do our job. But there's still the proximity issue. Often you'll be on a stage, removed from the audience, so you might be able to see your client, but it would be harder for you to interact with that client because of the physical distance between you. This then impacts on the level of involvement of the interpreter. So this notion of role, which I'll talk a bit more about in a moment, and how involved you are as a participant, which is a slightly controversial issue anyway. And you'll see throughout the rest of the slide that distance and the nature of the assignment influences the quality, the power dynamic in that context. And all of that is influenced by how formal the setting is, whether how much of the information presented is oral information, or is in our case signed, or is written text-based information. And the nature of the interaction and the level of cooperation that's needed. In every form of discourse, in every form of communication, there are certain protocols. All communication is rule governed. So we know that in conferences there are certain protocols around who gets to speak when you get to ask a question, how and if you can interrupt the speaker. Same applies in court. There are very clear protocols and rituals around who can speak when, and it's very controlled. Whereas in many other community settings, there are different kinds of protocols around turn-taking, interruption, how you negotiate the interaction, who has the power in that dynamic to lead the discussion. Who's asking the question? And all of this stuff influences the way that we work as interpreters and the kinds of decisions that we have to make as interpreters. In community settings too, there may also be shared or conflicting goals. So in a conference setting, you would imagine that generally everyone would have a shared goal. The purpose of a conference is for people are there to learn about research and to be kept up to date with developments in their field. In a courtroom setting, there potentially would be conflicting goals. A defendant wants to be found not guilty. The prosecuting lawyer wants to find that person guilty. So not everybody has a shared goal. So when you put an interpreter into that mix, that's something that we need to consider. So when we start to unpack these parameters and look at this typology, we can see how complex community interpreting is because there are so many layers of things for us to consider. Here's some pretty pictures to illustrate some of what I've been talking about. So this is a picture of a doctor-patient interaction in a spoken language. And you can see that the power dynamic in this context, the proximity between the participants, the the nature of the interaction, who's asking the questions, the level of formality in this context could be very different from the next. The next picture illustrates a conference speaker. And in this is actually an unusual situation where the conference speaker has an interpreter next to them, and the interpreter is actually interpreting consecutively. Because you can see in the picture that she has a microphone, so the male speaker would present short chunks of information, which then would be interpreted consecutively by the interpreter. So in this instance, the interpreter has very close proximity to the speaker, but there would still be a major distance from the audience who were relying on that interpretation, because you can see they're seated on what looks like a kind of a dais or a stage of some kind. That distance would be exacerbated if that interpreter had been in a booth at the back of the room, like I said earlier, that and couldn't even be seen. The formality of conference settings is very different to that one-on-one doctor-patient interaction. Conference interrupting or conference speeches, the conference discourse tends to involve monologic text, so one-way monologue. Somebody gives a speech, and then there are very controlled question and answer sessions, usually at the end of the speech, a bit like we're having today, but ours will be slightly different, as opposed to a dialogic context, so a community interpreting context where there's to and fro, there's constant exchange between the participants. And the next picture, which is all very familiar to us, this demonstrates sign language interpreters working. Again, think about that typology. How does that apply to us? This kind of picture demonstrates that an interpreter always has to be seated at the front if it's a classroom or a lecture or some kind of event where more than one person needs to see, access that information. But if we think back to the doctor-patient interaction that I just showed you, their knees are almost touching. And if a sign language interpreter was in that context, they would have a much closer proximity in a much more informal setting. Chapter 4. So in previous times, there has been this normative definition of the role of the interpreter. So conceptually, spoken and sign language interpreters who are working in the community thought of themselves in this way. They saw themselves having the role to transfer the message, and that we were neutral, we were not an active participant, we were unobtrusive, non-relational, so we would not interact in any way with any participants, we were just there to facilitate the communication. No interventions by the interpreter, initiated by the interpreter, so we would only interpret what everybody else was saying. And when we would be likened to some kind of instrument, a telephone, or other metaphors we use, like a bridge. But essentially, our role was defined by these sort of parameters, which were equated with distance, neutrality, non-involvement, non-cooperation, non-participation. And Cecilia Bardenscher, who done lots of research in Sweden with spoken languages, she would call it the relay and talk function. So where we would see it that the only thing we're there to do is relay the talk, to tell person A what person B is saying, and vice versa. So this is what we would have previously referred to, or would still refer to, as the conduit model. That we are functioning as a conduit. And if anyone knows what a conduit is, you can see it's a pipe or some kind of mechanism to relay, usually an electrical charge or something like that. So this metaphor of a conduit implies that we have no impact on that message whatsoever, and that we have none involvement, and the message just passes through us like an electrical charge from person A to person B, and everybody's happy. We adopted this model from spoken languages, and spoken language model emerged out of conference interpreting, because community interpreting really has only been recognized as a distinct profession probably in the last 20 years in spoken language interpreting. And so it's after the seminal work of people like Cynthia Roy, who's actually from our sector, from the sign language interpreting sector, that we started to question this conduit model. We started to say, we're not conduits. We're not distant. We do have an impact. And Cynthia Roy's work, she actually did her dissertation, completed her PhD dissertation in 1989. So her work has had a major impact on our field in community interpreting generally, because she was one of the first people to question that model, that conduit model, and to provide evidence for why we should question it through her PhD research, where she analysed an interaction between a deaf PhD student and his university professor, and the interaction through the sign language interpreter, and what was really happening in that interaction. Was that interpreter just relaying the talk? What else was happening? So this has actually led to a bit of controversy, because people start to question the role of the interpreter and start to recognize that interpreters had more involvement. So in that reading from Franz Pochacker that you were given, he talks about this. Because around this time we started to say, is interpreting a form of mediation? We're not just relaying the talk, but are we mediating the communication? What do we mean by mediation? From a legal perspective, it has a very specific meaning. It has a very specific construct. Mediation means to intervene between conflicting parties or viewpoints. Whereas for our purposes in relation to communication, it's an activity of an intermediate, so a third person, to transmit something from one person to another. And in his chapter, Pochacker talks about the fact that there are different definitions of mediation. Some people talk about linguistic mediation, cultural mediation, interlingual mediation, intercultural mediation. But effectively, what they're all referring to is the fact that as interpreters, we are mediating, we are assisting, we're engaging in an activity to transmit a message, the meaning from person A to person B. So we're working between two languages and two cultures. So when we think about this act of translation or this act of interpreting, I'm using translation in the generic sense, we could think about mediating between languages and cultures. And Cecilia Bardenshire would talk about that as talk as text. So the talk from person A is considered to be a text, which the interpreter then takes, decodes, re-encodes, and then mediates that, relays that as a new text in the other language. But we all know that interpreting is a little bit more complex than that. That interpreting has an interpersonal function, because you're not just working between texts. You're actually working between people who are talking to each other. So when you're engaging in a form of interpersonal mediation, you're engaging in an activity. Talk as an activity. Because you are enabling communication to happen between a person or persons who don't use the same language. So it's not just text A to text B, it's this person wants to communicate with that person and they have goals that they need to achieve. They're there for a reason. What do they want to see as the outcome of this communication? So Cecilia Bardenshire talks about the fact that interpreters are coordinating the talk, because the talk has to happen through the interpreter. But it's not through the interpreter in that conduit sense, it's through the interpreter as in the interpreter helping you to understand one another and engage in this activity with you so that you can achieve your goals and communicate with one another. So this term came about, the interpreter-mediated encounter. And since the work of Cynthia Roy and Cecilia Bardenshire, we have all started to talk about interpreter mediation, interpreter-mediated encounters. What is interpreter-mediated communication? The work of Cecilia Bardenshire and Cynthia Roy have recognised that interpreters are actors, if you like. They're involved, they're participants in the social, cultural and institutional context. So the interpreter is integral and ensuring that the communication can happen and influences the nature of that communication, because they need to recognise those protocols I was talking about earlier, the discourse rules that each person needs to engage in different languages and different cultures have different rules. So the interpreter has to mediate that, they have to facilitate that, they have to engage with that process. So this notion of the interpreter as a participant draws on sociology and sociolinguistic theories to determine how the interpreters recognize the goals and the frames of reference of the participants. So in our case, a deaf person and a hearing person. But they also bring their own frames of reference. They also bring their own understanding of what they think is happening in this context and what's appropriate. They're making judgments about what's appropriate, and they're facilitating that. So they're mediating the communication to ensure that if person A doesn't intend to offend person B, that the interpreter will translate, coordinate that talk to ensure that person B doesn't get offended. Whereas if they interpreted directly exactly what person A had said, it might be offensive because of the way they'd said it. It's a cultural thing. And I'm sure, if you're all in front of me, I'm sure I'll see you all nodding in agreement based on your experience. So nod profusely, I'm sure we'll get the vibe. But the key thing around interactional sociolinguistics, so this theoretical model for exploring how communication happens, is that it recognises that meaning is always negotiated between participants. There's always a process of checking and understanding. So if it's a direct communication between person A, person B, you have that direct negotiation. Whereas when you have an interpreter there, the interpreter has to mediate that negotiation and sometimes has to do that negotiation themselves. So through the work of Gardner and Roy, they were two of the first people who really started talking about this, and there have been many, many others since. We recognised that there was a gap between theory and practice. And I mean former theories, you know, this conduit model theory. You can see on this particular slide there's a whole list of examples, and these are just a few examples, there are many others, of people that have identified that in their data, the interpreter is not a straight conduit. That in legal context, in medical context, educational context, whether that's in school-based education or in university-based education, in workplaces, we are seeing in spoken languages and sign languages that when we examine authentic interpreted interactions in context, in the setting, we can see that the interpreter is fulfilling this kind of role as coordinator of talk. So they're doing so much more than just relaying text A to text B and back again. So therefore they are a participant in the interaction. By being there, they do have an impact on the interaction. They do have an influence. They can't be completely neutral, completely impartial. Because just because they're there means it changes the dynamic. So we've all recognised this. We've said, hey, look, this is good. We now have this knowledge that that previous conduit model, which we had adopted wholesale, really, from the conference interpreting model, doesn't apply to us, doesn't work for us. And now we know that it's okay to say that. Because, again, I'm hoping that you're nodding along with me here, that as interpreters who are working in the community, often you go, this doesn't feel right. I know I'm supposed to be impartial, I'm supposed to be completely neutral, but there are things I feel like I need to do here to make this communication work, to make this communication happen, to make this communication effective. And you do it anyway, but not tell anyone that you're doing that. Right? I can see Gev in the corner here nodding, so that's a good sign. That, you know, we instinctively kind of felt that model didn't fit. So then all of a sudden we had this research evidence to confirm that. And what a relief for us as practitioners who are out there doing the work, that all of a sudden we had this validation of the work that we were doing. So we then moved on to think about the role continuum. So, you know, to see that there's a continuum that at one end of the spectrum, you have the conduit metaphor. So the interpreter is completely impartial. And that's relevant in some context. In a conference situation, you are more removed, you have more distance. And for spoken language interpreters in particular, that conduit metaphor does still work to a point. You have less impact on the interaction perhaps. To the other end of the spectrum where we recognise the interpreter's participant. So this led to a new paradigm. Excuse me. We started to challenge our notions of neutrality and impartiality and invisibility. The theory to say, I'm sure you remember, I'll just pretend I'm not here. You turn up an interpreting job, just pretend I'm not here, just carry on like that as if I'm not here. And now it's actually a way for us to say, I am here and I'm going to do my very best to make sure that you get to talk about what you want to talk about. And that it's okay if you want to address me directly to ask me a question so that I can clarify something, or can I ask you a question to clarify something, just to make sure that this communication is effective and it's happening, it's working, that's okay. And you don't need to say, oh, I'm just the interpreter, I'm sorry, I'm just the interpreter. Just ignore me. You can say, with pride, I'm the interpreter, I'm a language expert, I'm a mediator, and I'm here to help you. But not help in that paternalistic way, but to help as in, I'm an expert in communication and I can assist you to communicate, to interact, to talk. So there's more recognition of us as an active participant, as a mediator. This has helped us to redefine the whole model of community interpreting and to accept that it's complex. What we do is complex. So therefore, the role that we have is complex, and recognizing its complexity is a positive step. Saying it's not easy, and we know it's not easy, but we still do it well. So this new paradigm has had an impact on our pedagogy and on our practice. So we start to change the way that we teach interpreting students, which then inevitably has an impact on practice. We change the way that we talk about interpreting amongst ourselves in the conferences and just in dialogue with our colleagues. I remember when I was first trained, it was very much, you know, it's all about your errors and you don't produce errors, and accuracy means the less errors the better, and the less impact you have the better. Whereas now we teach interpreters about discourse. Think about what people are saying, why they're saying it, how they're saying it. Think about managing the communication, coordinating the communication, not just facilitating text A to text B, but think about what's happening in this dynamic. Think about your ethical decision making. Your code of ethics is no longer this kind of set of rules that you hide behind. You use it as a tool to assist you to say, okay, I can see that in this communication event, this needs to happen to make it work, and that's what I'm going to do to make it work. And so we're more reflective, more critical, I think, in our approach, linguistically and ethically. And I think this shift has been reflected in the kinds of publications that we're seeing. So if you look at the literature in teaching interpreters, CIT proceedings, and the interpreter education series published by Gallaudet University, the kinds of talk that we are having about interpreting education has changed. But, and I'm conscious of the time, I've gone over 45 minutes, but I am sort of getting to my key point, but we have plenty of time. I still think we need to be mindful of the use of the term mediation. I think that there is a potential conflict between the concept of mediation in the contractual sense, the legal sense of mediating between two conflicting parties, and the communicative sense. So I've just been talking about mediating, coordinating the talk, and this is what Franz Pochacker talks about in his chapter. And I like it because it is thought-provoking. And if you think about it, we've adopted this term mediation, but the contractual notion of mediation, the legal notion of mediation, relies on neutrality of the mediator. The mediator must be completely neutral because they are helping the conflicting parties to come to an agreement, whether it's through divorce proceedings, through some other employment contractual obligation. Whatever the issue is, the mediator has to be seen as neutral. But the communicative notion of mediation relies on the interpreter being a participant and not being neutral, completely neutral. I mean, neutral in the sense that they don't give their opinion, but not neutral in the sense that they don't have an impact on the communication, because they need to help to coordinate that. So should we be using this term mediation? One of my former colleagues who's done some research in legal interpreting with Korean spoken language interpreters, she did a huge survey of legal professionals, judges and lawyers, as well as interpreters, and was asking them about their notions of the role of the interpreter and interpreter mediation, and she used the term interpreter-mediated court proceedings. She found that legal personnel generally really strongly objected to the use of the term mediation because they did not see that it was the interpreter's role in the court. And again, they're coming from a very legal perspective, but they were saying, no, it's my job to do the mediation, not the interpreter's job. The interpreter's job is just to interpret, just to translate. So it's that perception, the construct of what do we mean by mediation? And it's a great quote from Franz Pocklacker. He says, every interpreter is a mediator between language and cultures, but not every mediator is an interpreter. I'll leave you with that thought for a moment while the interpreters swap. So what I'm suggesting is that maybe we shouldn't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Kyra Pollitt talked about this in a similar way approximately 10 years ago, where she talked about the pendulum swing from the conduit model to what then we were talking about the interactive model of interpreting, the ally model. And we embrace that change. When that pendulum swing happened, we were moved away from this more cynical, I suppose, if you like, approach to our work, to a more engaged approach, recognizing that we were working with languages and cultures and people. But she also said, hold on, but this conduit model has its place. For us as sign language interpreters, it has its place. And I found similar things and made similar recommendations with my research. And what Kyra and I were both talking about was the university interpreting in particular, where in a tutorial setting, you might need to engage much more with an interactive model or with an interpreter mediation model, where in a tutorial, the goals are very different. The parameters in that interaction are very different. The student needs to be able to understand the content. They need to be able to discuss.
The last point I made was Hello, can everybody in the captioner in particular hear me okay? Just check before I continue. Can everybody hear okay? Yes, better? Okay, yes, fine, excellent. I will continue. We're on the home stretch. So as I was saying, there is a growing body of work in spoken language interpreting studies, looking at what interpreters are doing in the community settings, and which validates all the conference interpreting research that's been done, but also distinguishes community interpreting as a different form of practice. But we still need more dialogue between research and practice, because often it's those of us who are out there at the coalface, like I said earlier, we have this instinct. We sense what's working and what isn't working. And we need the research to collect the evidence of what's happening so we can then talk about that in pedagogical terms, which so it influences pedagogy, it influences policy, and then also influences practice and validates what we do, confirms what we do, but also challenges our thinking around what we do. So we don't want that kind of gap to happen. As I mentioned earlier, there was this gap between the theory and the practice. There was this notion of the conduit model, but what was happening in practice didn't reflect that. So there needs to be a dialogue between the research, which generates the theory, which links to the practice. And I really think it's critical for interpreters to be researchers. And Daniel Gille, G-I-L-E, coined this term, I think in the late 80s, maybe early 90s, where he talked about practice searchers, practitioners, interpreters, who become researchers. And other people in spoken language interpreting and myself and others in sign language interpreting have talked about this need for research on interpreting to happen and be led by, I think, practice searchers. And I'm not invalidating the work of career academics, so academics who aren't interpreters, because there are linguists, there are psychologists, there are many different academics who contribute to our knowledge of what we do through their research, but I think it needs to be done hand in hand with practice searchers. So the research that was done, which led us to this notion of interpreter mediation, came about from Cynthia Roy, is a practice searcher. She started out as an interpreter. Cecilia Bardenshire started out as an interpreter. So often the research that changes our thinking, that pushes the boundaries, is generated by those interpreters who are seeking questions to explain what they see in their everyday practice. So it feels very strange holding the phone like this. So when we think about our expertise as sign language interpreters in the community, our expertise, our roots are in the community. That's where we started. For spoken language interpreters, they started to be recognized as a profession in the conference setting. It's only more recently that we've seen more work in community interpreting, or recognized work in community interpreting, but for us, it's the other way around. We started in the community. And more these days, we're seeing lots of demand for conference interpreting because more deaf people are achieving a higher level of education, taking on professional roles and attending conferences, aside from the deaf community conferences that we've had around for a very long time. And spoken language interpreter researchers, scholars and practitioners have begun to recognize that in the community interpreting sector, sign language interpreters have actually led the way. We were the first ones to say, this conduit metaphor doesn't work for us because we're face-to-face with our clients all the time. It doesn't fit. But now I think we need to have more of a bridge between spoken and sign language interpreting research. We've tended to stick to our own domains, our own typologies. Sign language interpreters do research on sign language interpreting, spoken language interpreters do research on spoken language interpreting. But we need to see more comparisons across languages, across cultures, because there are many similarities. We know there are many differences, but there are so many similarities that we can learn from one another. There is a growing body of research in sign language interpreting. We've been talking about sign language interpreting in a scholarly way for a while now. But one of the things I particularly liked about the chapter from Lorraine Leeson and her colleagues, which you have been given to read, is that they talk about the emerging nature of sign language interpreting research and the fact that we've still got a long way to go. And I think that the three-way approach that they talk about also applies to spoken language interpreting research in the community sector, in community interpreting. First of all, Generation Zero research, where it's basically people describing what they do and being prescriptive. So this is what happens and this is what should happen. But just often from observations and descriptions of experience, but there's no evidence base. And then we move into first generation research, where we start to have more theoretical considerations and more evidence-based analyses of what it is that we actually do, not what we think we do, but what we actually do and what that means. And not necessarily prescribing what we should do, but acknowledging, well, okay, this is what we do, Is that acceptable? If not, why not? If so, how can we teach it? Being reflective, being critical, and being provoking, thought-provoking sometimes. And I think we're still at this stage. We're starting to move into the second generation of research where we're starting to explore how students and how professionals actually apply the knowledge from the research in their practice. So how do we see that practice improving or changing? Yeah? We're kind of on the cusp of that, I think, but we still need more of this first generation research to be able to move into doing more second generation research. So in terms of future research, I think I would agree with Lorraine Leeson and her colleagues in saying that there are three strands, we need three key forms of research. Research that feeds into our teaching, so that we can think about what strategies that we use as interpreters. Research that leads to the development of tools, resources that can be used by interpreters to enhance their work, and also research that leads to a better understanding of our limitations. So not only, okay, these are the strategies that we have, but recognising when those strategies don't always work and having a balance. I strongly believe that there's a need for more joint research across spoken and sign language community interpreting researchers, practitioners and researchers. But I also think there needs to be more, and Deb and I were just talking about this earlier, more joint research across sign language interpreting communities as well. So comparing ASL interpreting with Auslan interpreting, with British Sign Language interpreting. Because again, there'll be commonalities, but we're all influenced by our own cultures in our own countries. And we need to be asking those questions. So do we mediate? How do we mediate? When do we mediate? Why do we mediate? And should we mediate? Going back to that question of what it is that we're doing and finding more evidence for it. So not throwing the baby out with the bathwater, not embracing this notion saying, yes, this is what we all do, because sometimes maybe we don't. And there'll be reasons for that. And we need to explore that further to identify more questions which we'll continue to explore, analyse and discuss amongst ourselves as a community. So that brings me to the end of my presentation. It's taken me longer to get through it than I thought, but I was conscious of the interpreting, the captioning, not speaking too fast, the technology. So I thought it was worth slowing down to make sure that people could engage as much as possible. So that leaves us about 20 minutes for questions. And I believe Deb is going to field your questions that you have sent in. So I'll be handing the phone to her. She'll be reading out the question, and then I will be answering the question, and we'll have some discussion, hopefully, before we have to finish. So I'll hand the phone over to Deb now.
Thank you so much, Jemina. That was a fabulous webinar, and people have so, so enjoyed your translation of the research and what it means for us as practitioners. So we have a number of questions that have come in, and the first one is, can you speak to how team interpreting might fit into the context and the concept of mediation?
That is a very, very good question. I could probably do a whole webinar just on that. Wow, where do I start? I think that team interpreting is a whole other construct. And as we know, our thinking around team interpreting has also shifted dramatically. It's a whole new paradigm around what it means to work as a team. I remember when I first started interpreting, working in a team meant I was on and then I was off. And when I was off, I went to the bathroom, I made phone calls, I read the paper, I did the crossword, you know. And it never felt right. but I did it because my colleagues did it, and we all kind of perpetuated this notion of, well, if they're going to do it, then that's what I should do too. But then we realized that we had this huge resource there that we could use. And so over time we've recognized that team interpreting is about support. And I think the key is team interpreting is about coordination. So if you think about Vardensher's notion of coordination of talk, that's what we do as team interpreters too, because when you're interacting directly, you think from an interactional sociolinguistic perspective, is you're negotiating the talk. So you're negotiating meaning with the person you're talking to. So when you have an interpreter present, the interpreter is coordinating that function and assisting with that negotiation to find meaning. And when you have two interpreters or more, but two interpreters working as a team, they are working together and coordinating together to work with you to achieve that communication. So interpreters are monitoring each other, negotiating meaning between themselves to then assist with negotiation of meaning between participant A and participant B. So interpreters are monitoring, they're checking for understanding, they're clarifying, they're supporting. And so I know now that when I teach interpreting students, I don't talk about the on and the off interpreter. I talk about the interpreter who's in the hot seat. And I talk about the fact that the interpreter who's in the hot seat is the one who's active. But the interpreter who is their team support member is still active, but active with a small a as opposed to active with a big A, if you're going to apply the big D, little D convention. The small a active interpreter is constantly monitoring and checking for the coordination that's happening, and they might also participate in that coordination if need be by letting the hot seat interpreter know that something's not quite right or something else needs to happen to make it work better. And that's the very first time I've ever thought about applying that theoretical model to team interpreting. And I think there's a whole other research project there. So thank you for whoever asked that question. That was a really great question.
Thank you. Our next question speaks to the idea that sign language interpreting in other places appears to be grouped by, in the articles, professional and non-professional categories, while here in the United States we tend to group by environment or setting, so education, legal, medical, legal. Can you speak to this delineation here and abroad, and whether this impacts the degree of mediation that one might expect?
Wow, these are great questions. Okay. I think that the distinction between professional and non-professional is primarily, and when you say abroad, I'm thinking of spoken language interpreting rather than necessarily sign language interpreting, because I think in sign language interpreting, we do categorize according to setting, to context. And I think the distinction between professional and non-professional, the spoken language interpreters, is being because of the lack of recognition of interpreters in the community having any professional status. So there wouldn't necessarily be any training, because the only people that could get training before were conference interpreters. You could do a conference interpreting course, but there was no community interpreting course that you could do. So that meant that people that were interpreting in hospitals and in doctors' surgeries and in courts were perhaps family members, but were just, you know, bilinguals who happened to be able to use both the languages, and they would help their community, but they might never have had any training, or they might not necessarily have the competence to do the job. So there has been quite a lot of research, for example, in medical context and healthcare interpreting that talks about the risks of having untrained interpreters and the impact that that can have on that mediation, because even though we can talk about interpreter as participant and interpreter as mediator, there's still a line, isn't there? that we don't cross. You know, you don't tell somebody what to do. You don't inject your opinion. You don't intervene. You only participate in a sense of coordinating that talk, coordinating the communication and making sure that the communication is happening, but not in terms of the content. And I think that the distinction between sort of professional and non-professional is more about the fact that, okay, somebody can be a mediator of communication, but they might still overstep that mark. They're too much of a participant. And before, I think we would have talked about people stepping out of role. And I think that we need to change the way that we talk about that. And rather than saying we step out of role, it's just saying that you're pushing the boundaries of that role, or that you are participating in a way that means that you're no longer just coordinating the talk. It's a different kind of participation. I hope that answers the question.
I think you've addressed this one a little bit in your last answer, but where do you draw the line on cultural mediation, especially between deaf people and non-deaf people who may have a friendship or a relationship? So the question, sometimes deaf people may be perceived to be more direct or blunt, and so may say to person B, wow, I haven't seen you for a long time, you sure got fat. And so how far do we go with that? You know, do we say, I almost didn't recognize you, or do we say, wow, you really got fat? Because the goal isn't to insult, but based on the friendship. So do you want to comment a bit more on that?
Again, a great question, and I think Deb has alluded to it there, is ultimately it's about the goals. What are the goals of the interaction? Does person A really want to offend person B? Are they making a comment about the fact that they have changed the way that they look? What's the purpose for them in giving that feedback? And this is a classic example that we talk about a lot, and I've been in those situations where I have interpreted it more literally, so I have conveyed that, wow, you've put on weight, and the response has been, well, speak for yourself. Because of the friendship, you know, you make a judgment on who person A is, the deaf person, and who person B is, the non-deaf person, and what kind of relationship they have. So you've got to assess the interpersonal nature of the communication. What relationship do they have, and is this going to give them the opportunity to have this jibe, to have a bit of to and fro, or is this inappropriate? Is this going to cause offence, and could communication break down as a result of an unintended offence? And you know, the thing is, as interpreters, what we often acknowledge is that we're the only one, usually, in any interaction that knows exactly what's intended. And we're the only one that understands both languages and knows both cultures and understands what the shared goals of are of that interaction. And sometimes we have to make assumptions. We have to say, I know this deaf person doesn't mean to make offence, but if I know that if I interpret it this way, it will, and then the whole communicative event will go to a completely different place. There are arguments for being, you know, relaying the talk, relaying the text, so saying, yes, you've put on weight, you're looking very fat, and letting the communication break down so that the deaf person can learn that that's not appropriate. So how are they going to learn about those hearing norms? But surely there's other ways of doing that. We often talk about the fact that as interpreters, we represent the whole interpreting community and sometimes the whole deaf community. You know, one hearing person's experience of interacting with one deaf person with an interpreter can cloud their whole judgment about the deaf community and interpreters in general. They can label everybody based on one experience. So if they meet one deaf person that offends them unintentionally, then they might then have a perception about what all deaf people are like. So I think there's no black and white answer to this. It's, you know, like with any kind of dilemma that we discuss like that, I think that it's complex and we have to make these kinds of decisions very carefully and think about why we're there in the first place, but really why the participant A and participant B are there in the first place and what they want to achieve from that interaction. So I'm sorry it's not a very straightforward answer, but I don't think there is one.
Thanks, Jemina. I think this will be our last question, unfortunately. The question is, I'm trying to apply this to educational interpreting and how coordinators of talk can be mindful of mainstreamed deaf children's cultural development while interpreting. So how much mediation should occur in a setting like an educational setting, and what might that look like?
I could blame the fact that my jet lag is kicking in again to say that I don't know the answer to that question, but I won't. But that is a very interesting issue for us to consider. I was saying to Deb earlier that I'm involved in doing a research project at the moment looking at some classroom-based interpreting with high school students and actually trying to look at what kind of interaction is happening and how it's happening. And what we've observed, just from very preliminary observations, is that the interpreter is mediating the student's learning. I think that's the key. Because, again, if you think about the goals, why are they there? In an educational context, students are there to learn, teachers are there to teach. And teachers are there to ensure that the students learn, and it's their role to ensure that the students learn. Some teachers are better at that than others, yeah? And students need to engage with their learning. And sometimes, again, going back to the previous example, it's only the interpreter that understands or realises, recognises that there's something missing or that there's something not happening, so that the student can't engage with their learning because there's one vital piece of checking that the teacher hasn't done, or there's one concept that the teacher hasn't expanded upon that you know that the deaf student needs in order to engage with their learning. So we've seen examples of very subtle coordination where an interpreter will relay the talk, so we'll relay the text, so the teacher is giving a definition of something, I can't remember the exact details, but and the interpreter is signing that, so is using a, you know, a more literal sort of approach. But then what they do very subtly, and I'll demonstrate, I go, tiny, tiny, eyebrow raise, slight move of the head, and a very, very, I think the sign, understand, was actually kind of signed down here. So when you first do a pass through of the data, you probably wouldn't even notice it. And then when you slow it right down and you see it, and it's a really subtle, tiny, tiny checking mechanism happening with the student. And the student, we had two cameras, so, and the student gives a very subtle response. And I'll demonstrate. The student just goes, I don't know if you can even see it, it's probably too small, but like very slight squinting of the eyes, very slight tilt of the head, like minor. But enough for the interpreter to go, no. I didn't think so. I had a, you know, I had an instinct that they didn't get it, and I checked and they didn't. So now I'm saying to the teacher, can you explain that again? Or can you clarify? Or can you expand on that? So in terms of coordinating the talk, what's happening is that in classroom situations, it, you know, there is a level of interaction, but again, it's rule-driven, it has protocols when the teacher asks a question, the student responds. If the students want to ask a question, they have to do it in a certain way. And as we know, in a classroom, the teacher asks a question, an open question to the class, student calls out a response. By the time the interpreter's finished signing the question, it's already been responded to by somebody else, and the deaf student doesn't even get a chance. So that coordinating function, I think, that interpreters have in the classroom is about trying to ensure that students can engage with their learning and giving them the opportunities to engage. So whether it's speeding up to allow the deaf student to quickly jump in, or there are lots of other strategies, but I think that is the key. And that was very quick off the top of my head application for the theory then. Thank you for the question.
Well, Jemina, thank you so much for a really thought-provoking webinar. I know that we've had a number of positive comments throughout your talk this evening. And so thank you to all of you for joining us this evening. We appreciate your patience with technology in order to access what was exceptionally good content. So thank you for your patience on that. I know that some of you are watching this in homes as groups and are holding wine and cheeses after and talking about the workshops. So I appreciate you creating such a learning community. And I appreciate, Jemina, you doing one more presentation in what has been an incredibly busy week here. So thank you again for your time and talent. I have a few housekeeping things to finish off with. But I did want to mention as well, too, that Jemina had you read Lorraine Leeson's work and the work of Lorraine and her colleagues. So this is just a shameless plug for AVLIC 2012. Lorraine Leeson will be one of our presenters this summer in Calgary. So if you're interested in her work, then we would really invite you to come to Calgary to the AVLIC presentation. And she'll also be participating on a panel which is entitled The Myth of Neutrality. And there'll be plenty of food for thought there too. So please join us for AVLIC 2012. You can check the website for that. Last but not least, again, thank you to our communication team. Thank you to the captionist and the interpreting team. Thank you to all of you for participating. Reminders, if you are collecting RID CEUs, those can be requested by completing the request form, which appears after the satisfaction survey is completed. The survey opens once you close out of the webinar software. So once you leave Illuminate, then that will appear. Submit the survey, and you'll see a screen where you can click on a form to request CEUs. The form must be filled out if you are collecting CEUs. If technology isn't our friend, if the survey doesn't automatically open once you close out, then go to the web page for the webinar that was provided to you in the email from Robin and Amy, and that will link will take you to the survey at the bottom of the page. A group sign-in sheet was attached to the email that was sent to you on Tuesday, so if you watched as a group of individuals, and I know some of you did, then if you can have everyone sign in and submit the form, that would be fabulous. And I encourage everyone to complete the survey and to invite you to the next webinar, May 26th, which is a Saturday, 2 p.m. Mountain Standard Time, 3 p.m. Central Standard Time, and 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. The title of that webinar given by Robin Dean is Integrating Observation and Supervision into Your Program Curricula. So watch for registration to open soon. So once again, thank you very much for joining us for this webinar. We hope that you've enjoyed it as much as we have here in the room. Thank you.